So it was, I think, our determination of how we saw this category in our minds and thought that how it should look after 5 years. So to achieve that, and for that to happen, we had taken that on our shoulders to make it happen, right? So even though it was a desert, we were making sure that we are going to create skyscrapers out of nothing which exists today.
This week's guest on Questions I Wanted to Ask are two very inspiring founders of brands like Beardo, Villain, and now Rene Cosmetics, Ashutosh Walani and Priyank Shah. This conversation with them is not just like a masterclass on how to market homegrown brands, but also a much deeper understanding of how to create something that does not exist earlier. Ashutosh, Priyank and I spoke about all of this, their friendship, how they operate together, and things I've learned from both of them over the years I've known them. This is a very, very interesting episode for anyone who wants to understand building a brand, being an entrepreneur, and the journey that any entrepreneur goes through. Ashutosh and Priyank, welcome to Questions I Wanted to Ask. Thank you so much for agreeing to do this after a very, very long chase, especially when both of you are coming together to do this.
Thanks a lot, Anshu. I think it's all of a pleasure being here.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for having us. I think the best of the best interviews come after a long wait, right? So that's how it
goes. Absolutely. In fact, Priyank was telling me just before we started recording this that he's never... You guys have done very few ones together. Like, you normally give separately. Does that happen or you always give together?
Yeah. No, I think we always give... I think this is our second interview together.
He's our... Ashutosh has been always... You know, our speech man, when it comes to speeches and all, I like to be in the shadows.
So, yeah, thank you so much. It means that, you know, it's a very, very special interview. And I'm, you know, all through these years, I've had the opportunity to work with the both of you very, very closely at different stages of my career. And, you know, there's been so much of learning involved that it's, you know, anybody who I feel that, you know, some of the best branding that has ever happened in the retail business has happened on brands like Beardo. So I'm just very excited to talk about everything that, as well as the individuals that the two of you are and how you've managed to build whatever you've built. Tell me something, Beardo, Villain, now Rene. What phase of life is it, like, as maddening as what it used to be during the Beardo days, or now you guys have just like calmed down and like things are at a much better pace?
Yeah, so I think it is even worse now. So I mean, worse in a much better way. Very weird to use both of these words in a single sentence, because I think Beardo was always our first baby, right? Where we were out there to prove something. So it sure. was really fast and it was really quick. There were a lot of things that we were also learning along the way, right? And I think after Beardo, for you know, Villain and Rene, I think that became much more streamlined, right? And a lot of processes came into place. And that actually made us much better in understanding how what has to be done. Certain things take a certain amount of time, which now we are okay with. Previously, we actually weren't okay and we really wanted everything yesterday, right?
Yeah.
So I think that has changed. I think that understanding has really come in. And I think that has really helped me and Priyank, you know, build, you know, better businesses much faster now.
Interesting. Tell me, you know, Ashutosh, both you guys are known to be like the masters of branding. And this is a personal experience. I know that there's nobody else in the business of retail brands who understands digital marketing or actually content like the two of you, right? Priyank, I'm going to divert the question to you. You guys actually, a lot of people don't know that before Beardo, you guys had, you know, a venture before and a lot of your learnings came from there. So people who think that Beardo was your first venture and then you succeeded, it's actually not true. You had a lot of learnings before that venture also, right? What was that and what were the learnings there that you actually put into Beardo to make it what it is today?
Absolutely, Anshu. Before Beardo came into existence in 2015, late 2015, me and Ashutosh both were hustlers. Okay, it was like street salesmen kind of people we were. Back in 2010, we had a very quirky website. That was the first basic step to come into this e-commerce industry, which was termed as AajkiItem.com. Okay, I know the name sounds a little quirky, but I think at that point of time, that was what it was selling. So the overall concept was to give one day one deal, kind of overall fee to this consumers, because people were very fairly new to the e-com as an industry. Plus, getting payments and everything online also was really a task at that point of time in 2010-11, when we both were also new and the overall industry was booming. So at that point of time, we thought of getting into e-commerce space, but it was not only e-commerce space, but at the end of the day, you had to also sell. What would sell? How would it sell? And you have to pre-plan. Because, you know, most of the time we were relied on multiple people, may it be vendors from China or Mumbai or from multiple industries. The reliability was not. Okay, at that point of time, we understood what would work and what would not work and what we should rely on. And that was the existence of our own mindsets, that let's build a brand no matter what. At the end of the day, we don't just want to be a trader. We want to create something. At the end of the day, we all can be replaceable. But yes, brand would never be replaceable. We remain or not, but the brand would remain for sure. And that was the Eureka moment for us, that we thought, okay, let's try and build a brand. Before Beardo, we tried and build multiple brands, which did not succeed. But yeah, Beardo was our first baby, which we gave all of our hearts and soul to, and thought of let's jump into this no matter what. Let's do it. So that's how the overall feel, or maybe the overall understanding of the market came. So it was like 5 years of our blood and sweat kind of thing, literally, which came into existence. And that's how Beardo came into the play.
Interesting. And this is all the while, you actually started that while you guys were in college together, right?
We had just passed out.
It was my last year, and Ashutosh just finished his master's.
So you're literally like your early 20s. And for the next couple of years, you guys just probably created brands or whatever, like as Priyank said, which did not work. How was it? Like those four or five years when whatever you created did not work. What were the thoughts? What were you thinking at that time?
So I think previously, right? So since Priyank said, since 2010-11, what we used to do were, we were not out to create brands, right? We were out to trade products, right? So we were sourcing products and then actually going to the marketplaces and actually selling them. There was this funny moment where we used to buy products from one shop, and on the same street down the line, we used to go and sell it for a rupee or a 2 rupee or a 5 rupee margin, right? But there was a lot of there was a lot of volume happening. And we used to really have fun, right? So we used to probably start our day in the morning, go to the streets, like literally, go to a wholesaler, buy the whole bulk. So then on that whole street, we never used to own a shop, right? We were only virtual, we were only on online. So most of the stocks we used to sell online, right? Now, rest of the stocks, which was now with us, we used to sell it at a premium at the same street level to all the shops, but in a much smaller volumes, right? But then we used to liquidate the stocks really fast, right? So that was what we were really, really skillful at, because we would understand of what people are looking for, what are the price points we could really charge. And while we were doing this, we actually started controlling the prices of certain commodity goods, right? Like, let's say for an example, there was a time when we used to control the prices of yoga mat, which went out here online and on those particular streets, those B2B channel streets, right? So I wouldn't say that we did not succeed. Our focus was not to really create a brand then. Our focus was to churn around products as fast as possible and earn profits out of that trading. Yeah. And earn profits as a business. It was much later on that we realized that the real money is actually not in trading. It's in creating a value out of a business, out of a brand name. Right. And that's what happened.
Interesting. And that kind of, so that kind of laid the foundation of whatever then you finally went on to create Beardo with. Tell me, so when you first thought of, starting Beardo, and you actually have done all this while staying in Ahmedabad, which I think around 6-7 years back, it was still very new. Were there thoughts that, okay, if we are going to operate from here, how are we going to be left behind? Because Ahmedabad, at that point of time, wasn't the destination for creating. Today, of course, you can create from any part of the country, right? But you guys literally started that trend. Didn't you kind of worry about those parts?
Maybe I'll just want to add here something. See, most of the industry, if you see in terms of pharma or maybe consumer durable industry, most of the industry have been taking their birth here. Okay, so what we feel is it's always a land of opportunity. Plus, in terms of the overall vibe here, in terms of mindsets, are pretty sorted. So when it comes to doing business, the ease of having business here have always been fundamentally well for us, because you know a lot many things can happen here because there is ease of time, resources. Maybe you can at least conclude 8 to 10 meetings here, wherein in Mumbai or maybe other metros, we can only conclude 2 or 3 meetings because of the constraints and all of that other factors. So what we've always seen this as an opportunity, because you have much time to think for brand, for yourself, for a lot many things, rather than just getting into that other detailing.
So just to add to that point, right? So what me and Priyank actually figured out is that if we are doing something new for which we don't find the resource, or the right resource or the skill set, why not hire our own friends, right? And teach them, right? While we are doing that, create an atmosphere just like it was back in college days. Have this fun atmosphere to work at while everybody is learning from each other, right? Even us, right, for that matter. So we were learning from each other while we were having fun and while we were building this brand. So what happened suddenly was everybody was really living their work, right? So instead of coming to work, they used to stay at work and then go home for some time and then come back. So there were days where we were 16 hours, 18 hours at office. We used to play some sport, or we used to just chill around, probably do a lot of brainstorm sessions. And I think most of the ideas really came out of those particular discussions rather than concentrating on what should be the target, what should be the number. Now, because there was this close-knit group around, it became very easy for us to trust, right? Because trust factor is something that comes in, the understanding that comes in much easier, because all of us have been friends for more than like a couple of decades now. So I think that really played a factor for our growth as well.
Interesting. This reminds me of something, when I was working with you on Beardo and we were working on a couple of projects. Beardo, in fact, when it was launched, the look and feel of it was so international that it was quite amazing. I don't know how you guys had that foresight to create that kind of a brand. And what was interesting was all of this was done sitting in Ahmedabad. And I remember you telling me that this is actually being done by a friend of yours or somebody who's then later you hired or something. Do you want to talk about how you enabled that piece of designing and creating the overall look for Beardo? Because it's very interesting that this was all done sitting in Ahmedabad between the vision the two of you had.
Sure. I think with the creatives, I think if you see this side of mine and the left side of Priya, I think that was the inspiration for the logo, really, because we always had this kind of beard, right? And I think apart from that, we were very, very clear and focused on how should the brand really look like, right? It had to be inspirational. It had to be very, 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 very educative, right? Because I think a lot of acceptance of using the brand or the products of the brand will come from the right kind of language which is being spoken to the consumers, right? And which was very, very important. And I think that me and Priyank were very clear because we were one of the consumers also, right? So we spoke to the consumers like we would have liked to be spoken to. Right, Priyank, if you want to add.
Yeah, just to add one more thing here, we used to ask questions to ourselves, me and Ashutosh both to each other, that why would we want someone, some brand in our wardrobe? Okay, so there has to be an inspirational value that we kept on adding constantly to the brand. And that is the reason both of us have been working on the language very well. So, placing it internationally was very important for us, because then only you will have that following, which is cult in nature. Rest, we would have been just one other brand that no one wants to have in their wardrobe. So that was one, I think, question that internally we used to discuss every day, that, okay, why would you want me? What am I doing new? Or maybe what kind of language or what kind of content you want to see as a brand follower? So I think being a user plus also understanding and visualizing the brand was a step that we take or maybe used to take every day. So that helped us really well. Framing the overall language.
Interesting. Coming to framing the language, you guys, and I'm moving to how you guys function together. While Ashutosh generally handles the marketing part, and I think you handle the other manufacturing and that part, right, Priyank? I remember sitting in a music meeting with Priyank, and this was the first time I had met Priyank. two things, I think, which was quite obvious. First, immediate decision making. Even though you guys are sitting in two different cities, right? There was just a strong connect. And even though I will talk one thing to either of you, that message gets communicated very, very fast. I just want to understand, how do you guys function when it comes to work decisions? And sensibility also of having a similar kind of, you know, vision for the brand. Two questions,
To add here, first of all, I think since 2010, we both have been sharing the cabin. So it's me and Ashutosh, till date, we have the same cabin and the same workplace that we share. There's no two different cabins. So that is the ideology wherein we both think alike, because it's very important that you cannot think north and south at the same time. You have to think in one direction. So one is that, which has added up really well. Till date, we use the same cabin when it comes to working together. Other, in terms of decision making, I think it's very important to at least go and start with something rather than just wavering around anything or maybe just fumbling that, okay, what decision to make or not. I think let's I would be more than happier to fail rather than not trying. Yeah. So that is the overall mindset also that we have, that let's do it. It should click at one go. And if it clicks, I think because we have the same kind of gut, but now if in case it clicks, it has to go.
Yeah. And also, because what happens is, because we have been spending so much time together, right? A lot of our thought processes are very, very similar. Secondly, what we've always learned is always over-communicate, right? Not to under-communicate, right? So even if there is some small thing happening, we are always apprised of you know, what is happening in each other's life, right? Also, there is the third factor, which plays a really important role in this friendship and in this partnership, is blind trust, right? Even if somebody is doing something wrong, the other person is always there to pick it up, right? So because it's never going to play as a blame game, but it works. If something has gone wrong, let's work to bring a solution towards it. So there is a blind trust that even if a decision is going wrong, it's all right. I am always there to back him up, or he's always there to back me up on it. So I think a call is taken and then we follow up on that call very strongly.
Interesting. But do you guys have, I'm sure you have, but what happens when you guys have disagreements? Who has the final say? How do you arrive at a final say?
I think just like any two men who belong to the sector, right? We just fight it out and then probably end the day with a beer. And then while we are having that beer is when the decision is made, not during that fight, right? Because ultimately fights are bound to happen, right? So we have a lot of disagreements. Not a lot actually, but a few. But we always make it a point that after that disagreement, never to take a call, right? The call is always taken with very calm mind while we are having a drink or two, and then probably, you know, discussing the pros and cons, and then come to a mutual call. And that has always happened, and that has always worked for us.
Priya? I think brand is above everyone is the notion that we both have. So what works well for brand is the decision for both of us. That's how it has gone since days. So no matter what, you may be right or wrong, that should not matter. What is needed for the brand matters.
So as the company grows, as the brands that you've been putting money and time into grows, there are obviously other people who come into the equation, right? So for example, with Billin, you've had other investors and, you know, faces. With Rene, you have Ashika. How does that chemistry then work? Because till now, it was only the two of you. Now it's another person. And of course, somebody has to balance it. Somebody has to take sides. How does that work? Of course, because also as a brand grows, you know, the requirements grows.
This is a very tricky question. I will get in trouble. So I will have Priyank answer that.
I think what I always feel is it's always a blessing to have more people. More thoughts make it make life easier in terms of brand. But when it comes to different mindsets, what we feel is that at least me, Ashutosh and Ashka, all of us are pretty much aligned when it comes to brand. And we have the same ideology that no matter what, brand comes first, then every one of us. So there's not much. Yeah, in terms of getting products or maybe any other brand campaign and all, but that's okay. That's part and parcel, which we feel as a blessing, and maybe at a later stage it helps us a lot. So we know each other better rather than
sure.
So that has been a blessing.
So I think actually that works in our favor is what I just realized, right? Because when it's me and Priyank, the vote is 1:1, right? Now when there is a third party, the voting, so the majority voting, plan becomes easier, right? So that process, when something goes to vote, now we'll at least have a 2:1. So some particular matter is now being won by a majority and not stuck or not getting stuck at 1:1. Okay, yeah, do you want to do this or do you want to do this? Now there is a voting, amongst three of us. But again, like Priyank said, the intention is the same, right? The intention is to excel, is to thrive, is to make sure that brand is the one getting the advantage because all of us are now connected to it. There is no single person getting anything more out of it because all of us have always shared equal opportunities, right? So I think that intention of going forward with the same vision is really helpful. So at the end of the day, we all understand that even if there is a disagreement, at the end of the day, it is always good for the company, right? Of the company, thinking of it, right?
I think with Beardo and Villain, it was all black and white. And with now Rene, it's all colorful.
I was coming to that, having worked with the two of you, it's all very, very hardcore male. Of course, you have a lot of girls in your team, but having somebody at the leadership level. So with Ashka, you got that in Rene, right? Where you had a woman who's at par with you guys. How does that work? How do the equations change when you have a woman at the leadership level leading the, the brand and the company? What are the positives?
Yeah, so I think there are very, very less negatives, trust me on it, right? Because what happens is, me and Priyank get to do what we really like, right? Except here, we are not really in charge of the new product developments because we don't understand colors, we don't understand the products, right, that well. But we do understand marketing, we do understand the business side of it, we do understand offline operations, finance, right? So then what happens is, Priyank and I actually get to do with full freedom what we love. And then Ashka comes and takes over a part of the business that also we used to handle, but which she really understands better than us, right, in this case. So this actually becomes very easier for us, where she takes care of that particular segment, whereas me and Priyank take care of the segments that we love doing, right? So now the roles and responsibilities are equally divided. And that actually gives us more to think about, more to talk about, more to learn about also.
But tell me, this is just having another third partner, but do you feel that your approach in creating a retail or maybe especially a cosmetic brand, right, has changed with having a female partner in the company? Because the way a woman would think is very different than, the two of you would think because of pure usage or, how even in marketing. Do you think that there is a difference between how you used to operate in Beardo for the marketing campaigns versus how you operate here with Rene?
Oh, yes. Absolutely.
Okay, what I feel for the overall offline piece, I'll just like to share that bit. With Beardo, again, we close to somewhere around 35,000-40,000 outlets. With Villain, again, we reached around 4,000 odd outlets. Rene, we are at 4 outlets so far. But trust me, the overall pace that we've been working for all the brands, Rene is giving us beautiful figures and beautiful insights when it comes to understanding because of the overall cart value. When it comes to shopping, all the shoppers, though it be online or offline, I think all the shoppers are broadly female. Male shopping about themselves are few, wherein women shopping is a lot, which I feel is 80% or up. So in terms of going or growing, I feel Rene has more potential than all of the other brands because that's a clear leadership market that we've seen so far.
Yeah. So here's the consumer behavior difference, right? So if a guy generally, right, this is in very general terms, what we had noticed from Beardo is if a guy is out to get a face wash, he'll be like, face wash Dina, take the face wash, go away, right? But what we have seen now from the four outlets that has happened is the girl is there probably to window shop. She enters the shop, probably ends up buying a lipstick and then probably also ends up buying 2-3 more products with it, right? So while here the focus was to sell and it was very, very concentrated, here it is very holistic, which is very, very satisfying in a way where the intention was never to sell so many products to one person, but it always ends up being that, right? Because the products have also beautifully come together thanks to Ashka, thanks to Priyank, thanks to the whole team, right, working behind it. That the products have come out so, so beautiful that when a person is trying to come and buy one product, they end up probably buying 3 or 4, right? And that is also probably the consumer difference between a Beardo and a Rene today, right? Sure. Because they're speaking to only men. Here, we are only speaking to majority of, women. So I think that is also really working for us. And me and Priyank are the happiest, right? Because it was very difficult to sell a face wash ke saath oil bhi le lo. Here it's okay, you want to buy lipstick, you buy it, and she will be asking, I want 3 more products, right? And that is really fun.
Very interesting. Very interesting. That's why I tell a lot of people that if you want to understand insights, please sit with these two boys. There's nobody better in the business who will give you insights. But, you know, on that conversation, you're building a couple of other things and ventures, etc. I think, Ashka, also you knew since a long time, you know, before you started Rene. But just for people to understand, people who get into entrepreneurship, people who start companies, what are the basics one should keep in mind when you're actually, if you're blessed, you will have a friend who becomes your co-founder, right? And sometimes you actually just match because of your skill sets, right? What are the things that one should keep in mind when you are actually looking to start a company, look for in a co-founder?
No, I think while searching for a co-founder, right, if they are not friends, I think there are two major things that one should look at, right? One is the mindset. The mindset of both the co-founders have to be in sync, right? You cannot have too many differences in how you think. Second is the vision to what you want to do with the product or the company that you're working for, right? So if your mindset and if your wavelength and if the vision to where both of you want to get to together is aligned, I think then that co-founder really works well for both of them, right? And I think that is very, very important. Once I think that is set, once those basics are right, I think everything could be worked around, right? Because life does not come with a set pieces where you can just, you know, connect and you can just move on, right? Because I think we are, as humans, we always have to improvise. We always have to learn. And I think once these basics are set, you learn and grow together, right? So I'm sure Priyank and I are friends, right? But that does not mean that we always came with the same kind of, lifestyle or the same kind of thought process. But our visions and our mindset in base terms of what we want to do were always aligned. And that is what has worked. So you don't really have to be friends for that to happen. But you're always lucky to have a friend like that, right?
Yeah. I mean, especially because you end up spending almost more time creating or building that brand as compared to, at least in the initial stages, as compared to this thing. But tell me, does that mean also that you don't have to have similar kind of lifestyle or maybe values? I mean, very different things, but yeah.
Lifestyle, maybe not really, right? There are so many examples, right, in the world with so many brands where 2 or 3 or even 5 co-founders of a particular company have had very different lifestyles. Speaking of Apple, right, Wozniak and Jobs were 2 very different people with 2 very different values, with 2 very different backgrounds, right? But one has to lead, one has to make sure that everything is working well in the background, and that kind of a balance has to be maintained, right? If that balance is maintained, it does not matter, right? Because the vision for both of them was always clear of what they were trying to do, right? It's not the best example, but it is one of the biggest examples that people know and will actually connect to, right? Similarly, you will see a lot more other brands, right? Including, Microsoft or including any other brand that you speak of, you will always have people who will be thinking separately. But the vision that they have always executed for the brand, that has always been aligned, right? And that is where the win is.
Interesting. Another very important part they say that, you know, when you're building a brand is having mentors around you. Did you actually have people as mentors around you when you were starting that journey of building a brand? If yes or if no? I mean, either way.
I think with the Beardo days, what we did was the offline piece, which was fairly new for both of us, which I picked it up as a task. And which I felt that should have a lot of potential and all. Early days of Beardo, we were already in talk with Marico, and Marico, we had a strategy tie-up with Marico in 2017. At that point of time, we were trying to also build up our offline synergies and offline outlets and all of that. That point of time, what I literally feel is that Sanjay, from Marico, who is COO of Marico at this point of time, have helped us really well, at least me, in terms of framing the overall offline piece. Because our understanding of the offline piece was very, very basics, and they came up and added really, really well in terms of the value. And with that, we were alone able to reach out to 40,000 odd outlets within span of one and a half years, which I feel without that mentorship would have been a little difficult for us. So personally, in terms of that piece, we're really thankful to that person.
That's more technical. Sorry, that's slightly, if I have to put it, that's way more technical, right? More from an offline piece. But anybody who kind of just sat through your conversation, said, okay, this is where you are, this is where you might want to go. And, you know, whenever you had dips, to somebody to tell you, okay, no, it's fine and all of that stuff.
No. So, okay. So I'll take that one, right? Because I think for online or for creating a brand, I think we were mavericks, right? It was like the Wild West. Not a lot of people had already built a brand, right?
Yeah.
First of all. Second is, nobody really believed that two boys from a city that is not known as the startup hub comes out and brings a brand which is going to fight with these larger people and then create their own space, right? Because we were not getting into a category which was there and we were not trying to get a piece out of it, right? What Priyank and I were doing were creating a category of our own, right? Which not a lot of people had done in the past and not a lot of people were attached with this category. So whatever was happening was a first of its kind, like a lot of things, right? Including a campaign that we did, I think Such a Beardo, which was a song, right? That was the first that we did. Then there were a lot of campaign execution that was a first. A lot of products that we brought were a first, right, in India. So I think we were a lot of, you know, experimentations. We were a lot of, okay, if we fail kind of an attitude. And I think at that point of time, not a lot of mentorships were there around. But like Priyank said, right, there are key people who really helped us in understanding how we can grow faster and better. Some of our investors at VCATS, some of our investors and early believers at, you know, Marico. I think those are the people who really helped us after a certain scale to, you know, scale even faster and better, right? After giving us a lot of insight on data and how we should be looking at it. Till then, I think it was definitely like a Wild West for us. We were just exploring through and through.
Both of us mentored each other.
Which is interesting. I mean, it's always easy to build something that you can see, right? But it's always very difficult to build something that is not there. Which is what my question is. When you're building something which you cannot see or which is just in your this thing, what gets you through?
I think that is the determination of how you see the world when you build it, right? Mm-hmm. So it was, I think, our determination of how we saw this category in our minds and thought that how it should look after 5 years. So to achieve that, and for that to happen, we had taken that on our shoulders to make it happen, right? So even though it was a desert, we were making sure that we are going to create skyscrapers out of nothing which exists today. And that is what we are trying to do and achieve, right? And that's what we did. So I think our confidence and determination that, yes, we can make this happen, no matter what it takes, right? Because there was never a fallback plan. There was never a plan B, right? Either this is it or, you know, that's all for you, you know? And hence, there was this drive that Priyank and I always had to, you know, make this happen. There was never an option to say no or we'll fail. It was always, if we fail, we'll do it again. We'll try again. And I think that is what really drove us.
Interesting.
I think the desire to building something at the end of the day is what we all thrive for. And there is this ladder to success. Okay, so let's build something which is there to stay. So that was the clear intention for both of us to create a brand and to create something which is there and which is going to make value and make life beautiful at the end of the day. Yeah. So that was really,
Tell me, very interesting, because now what you're doing with Rene is actually opposite, right? With Beardo, you created a category. With Rene, you are actually going opposite where there is a category. But you are disrupting by introducing newer products and better brand and better experience and all of that. Now, in this case, how do you build it? How do you see this?
So, okay. So I will answer a part of it and then I'll probably pass it on to Priyank, because how we see it is, what we are trying to do is something, we always like to do something which has never been done before, right? So while it is a cluttered category, yes, we have identified a certain amount of space where there is a lot that could be done, right?
Sure.
Because this particular category is only growing by the day. What we have taken upon ourselves is to bring products that people will be seeing for the first time ever, right? to bring innovation, to bring new products. Once again, without that feeling of failure, right? That's okay, even if you do. But I think that is our purpose, to bring this. While we do this, we also think that there is a lot of space, because India is much bigger market than it is today, which will be after 5 years, right? So we are looking at ourselves and seeing, okay, where can we be after 5 years? Can we again turn this desert of being a mundane, you know, color cosmetic kind of a category into a very innovative, very experimental, very, very, you know, convenient and luxurious, you know, kind of a landscape of not. I think the answer is yes. And I think that is what we have taken up, you know, upon ourselves. So it is a bigger fish that we are out to catch this time around. Right,
Priyank? Interesting. Priyank?
So when we should not, but when we looked into a woman's bag, we saw that, okay, it's a clutter of product. Okay, like, let's make life simple for them as well. And yeah, that's how I think innovation comes into the picture. Because what we've seen when it comes to makeup, there is always this fight of selecting a right shade. How do you select the right shade? What product to carry in your pocket when you're going out? So that's how the invention of Fab Five came into place. Like, five lipstick in one. Okay. What we've also seen is that most of the women are still trying to understand what makeup is. It's not that elaborated in terms of usage and all. That's how we created, like, let's make your life easy. Let's have Fab Face, which is like your whole makeup story done with eyes, lips and face. You don't need to worry. You don't need to match shades and all. So I think that question again, here, that let's simplify it and let's make it better, because we are not one of the brand who's going to come up with 1,000 shade saying that, okay, now we are better than this and that. That's not us. Let's make it better is what the overall fundamental of our company is at this point of time. And that is working really well. And I think that should work well for us as well.
I think it's also one of my favorite. I was telling this to Ashutosh the other day. It's also one of my favorite products, the Fab Five thing. It solves a lot of problems, actually. coming back to my question, and this is to both of you, and you can choose to answer one by one. I consider you guys as somebody who understand content and the space of digital marketing very, very well. Yes, we've spoken on how you've learned those things, right? But now with so much of information, so many kind of courses, so many of, you know, different things required, whether for anybody who's in the business of content, entertainment, creators, marketers, what are those four or five important things that are required, whether it's through courses or that, you know, that you can learn? Of course, there is something called as your own intuition that nobody can, like, you know, teach you. But Ashutosh, maybe you can start with that. What are those four or five important things that one can really learn and, you know, be better at, whether you're a creator or you're a marketer, either of it?
See, I think point number one is always to understand what user or who is your user, right? Who are you speaking to as a brand or, right, or as a product or as a company? You have to understand the demographics really well, right? Once you have that, then you create a level two where you try to reach to them with the right kind of channels or via the right channels, right? So you can't have your audience in an Instagram and then be marketing them on a Snapchat, right? So that understanding of who your user is, what or where that user is spending most of their time, what is the kind of content that particular user is actually consuming. So then try to create that kind of a content and give them for consumption, right? And then probably will give you the insight on whether all of this is working for you or not. And if these three, four points are not really working for you, you get on the sketchboard and see what you can do differently. Or maybe you need to change your strategy a little bit. I think these are the three, four points which I would think are very, very important when you start something, right? So I think this is how I'd put it.
Very simple. From a skill perspective, Ashutosh, that marketers or creators need to understand, like any skill that they think is important, if you think, or there could be nothing.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I think, see, for a digital first brand, it is very, very imperative to understand how do you performance market, right? How do you market to get an ROI out of whatever activity you are doing? To do that, you have to understand data. For that, you have to make sure that you learn Google Analytics, you learn how to market on Facebook and Instagram and the Snapchat and the Tinders of the world. You learn to market, how do you use these tools, these Google tools, these keyword tools to your advantage to target it better, right? So I think these are certain skill sets that you should definitely take a course on. You should learn even if not to do it on your own, but just to understand so that you have better insights on what you're doing and whether it is working or not.
From my perspective, what I feel is a piece of content is always where I want to stop, watch it. And second part is I'll want to add it to my cart. That's how I see this business really straight up. That yes, there has to be a wow factor. Why would I want to spend my time on that piece of content? And it really has to instigate me to buy. If that is not answering, I would not really want to go ahead with that piece of content. I think for me, Ashutosh and Ashka at this point of time, it's the same thing. That yes, this piece of content is adding value and would at least add value to us as well. Let's go ahead.
Ashutosh, next question, because I know you work more on the creator side of things, and this is something that, you know, just came to my mind, but which is a very, very important question. You work with creators and you work on content a lot, right? And I know how you think in terms of your content. Like for you, content is first. You'll place the brand very nicely, but it's always the content. What is it that you would expect from creators or influencers now when they do brand marketing, right, through their platform? What are the kind of changes do you expect, or what are the things that you think that can become, make them better? Because this is also, you know, this has become like a place of confusion where brands are saying creators are just doing plain Jane marketing, and creators are saying brands are giving us, you know, briefs which doesn't work, right? How do you kind of come to a consensus in a situation like this?
I think now what has to happen is this, right? Previously, what used to happen was brand used to go with a mandate to an agency, right? Then agency used to, copy that mandate and go to these influencers. And then influencers used to give the deliverables. And, you know, that was how the transaction used to happen. But now what is happening is because of the empowerment of the digital age, there are a lot of more brands coming in. So this process has really become tedious, and people are not, none of these people are actually getting what they want, right? The influencers are actually not getting the right products to partner with. The brands are not getting the right influencers to partner with. The agencies are not able to do this faster. I think what has to happen now is a brand partnership between influencers and the brands to work together and come to a piece of content by understanding of who does that influencer is followed by, and for a brand to know, okay, is that the right influencer? Is yes. If yes, then what is the kind of content that she should be bringing out to the people that follow her or him, right? So I think the brand partnerships have to get stronger with the influencers, and both of them have to come together, brainstorm together to create a piece of content, right? Rather than me just sending you a product and you just saying, okay, this is the best product, right? And that is also not the truth. So there has to be a level or there has to be a category where that influencer, while marketing, should also give a truthful, insight on what she or he also thinks of that particular product, or they think of that particular product, right? I think it's very important that this has to now be a part of the process where influencer, without any reservation, can also rate a product, even though they have active partnerships with the brand. Though it may be biased a little bit, obviously, because that balance has to be maintained, because otherwise the influencers and the brand can't really come together. But I think that section has to be there where they can be a little bit frank about how or what they feel about the product, which is not happening anymore, which we see a lot often where the influencer is just coming and just probably putting up the product because that's what the brand wants. And it's not clear, right? So I think this is how I would put it. Work together, come together, understand what the product is, understand what the audience is, and how they should be targeted, right?
Okay. Priyank, my next question, and this is more or less the last part of the question from the content marketing perspective. Since you kind of deal a lot more on the offline, you know, part of this thing, do you think that there is a difference? Earlier, there used to be big stars and their faces, etc., on the creatives, etc. Do you think now with these creators, influencers coming in, that's making a difference in the offline sales, or it's only left to this thing? And you can choose to be politically correct.
I'm going to be honest on this piece of it. Yes, till date, it is a celebrity-driven market, no matter what, if in case it is online or offline. Yes, celebrities do drive the market, and that is upfront truth for all of us as an industry. So that is absolutely correct. In terms of, yes, now honest reviews about the product and all, I think celebrities have also gone forward and started only pick and choosing the brand which are adding values to themselves and maybe to the market, or else random celebrity endorsements have also stopped. But when it comes to offline piece, what we have seen is that A plus celebs have been working well, because there is no other educational thing which is going around. It is only the face value, because on sure. offline it's more to do with the posters and the danglers rather than maybe any other activity which in terms of e-commerce or maybe digital would add, wherein they can at least educate the product, what is it about, and they can do a lot many things which they have restrictions in terms of offline. So yes, A plus celebs still drive the market, and the offline and the overall education piece, what I feel it's a boon for the overall industry is that because of the education piece which is done online, you have that ripple in offline, because you don't need to the maybe a advisor on the store or maybe any salesman do not have to explain the product much. They know, and they now pick, the consumer pick the product by themselves rather than a store owner or maybe a beauty advisor recommending them, because they've already seen it online.
Interesting.
Yeah.
This was quite a class in understanding of how you've created this beautiful world of, amazing homegrown brands and which have gone, taken international place internationally. But tell me, Beardo, Rene, Villain, and I know you have a lot more plans. You guys have, I'm assuming, have achieved your some amount of basic financial goals. And this is to individually both of you the same question. Where do you see yourself? Like what now? Like what next now? What are your aspirations from individually, business-wise and individually? Priyank, you want to start?
What we absolutely feel is that it's all about the number in the bank. It does not work really well on that front. But what we personally feel is that it's about creating value. When we speak of value, it's the brand value that we speak of. Now, we always feel that we want to do multiple things. And that is the reason now the brands that we cannot do it by ourselves, we've started investing in the brands. And that is what helping us or maybe keeping us in the race alive. That's the best part that we can do with the funds that we have. Rest, what we see is that if in case it creates value for us, it's better. Rest, money does not excite anymore.
Interesting. So what do you aspire to now individually? Like considering you maybe have achieved the first step of your career, first aspirational goal of your career, for you individually, what makes a difference now? Ab kya? Okay, Ashutosh. Yeah, why not Ashutosh first?
Okay. So I think I fully agree with Priyank, right? After a certain amount of money, right? Money was never our primary driver. It was definitely one of the most important drivers, but sure. It was never our primary driver, right? Our driver was to create something of ourselves for which we are known for, right? Making a difference into the industry, making a difference into the category that we are playing in. I think that means a lot to us. After a certain amount of time, like Priyank said, it's just a number in the bank, which does not really matter a lot as much, right? Because yeah. Because most of our times, even if we have enough money, we don't have enough time to spend it, because we are still working towards what we want to achieve, which is much greater than just a little bit of money here and there, right?
Sure.
So I think that is not ever been our focus. But once again, I mean, all these statements only come from people who already have money, right? So I think we are not the fair people to say that money does not matter. It does, absolutely.
Yeah.
But after a certain point of time, I think that zeal of doing something I think that thrive, right? That instinct changes into now achieving even greater things, where sure. money is now absolutely out of the picture. So, it is more to do with.
So my question is, what is that greater thing? Because I know, see, a certain X amount of money in both of your bank account is done. Aapne brand create kar li, aapne category create kar diya. But up, what gives you happiness? Because it's a very philosophical question. But now, what will give you happiness, and what do you look forward to doing now?
So let's say we have conquered a smaller battle, sure. where the market was smaller. Now we are here to conquer, conquer in a much larger market, in a bigger battle. We have created a national brand. Now, also while we are doing this, we also want to create an international brand, right?
Sure.
And that is what, there has to be a brand out of India which the whole world looks upon. Right. And we feel that is our next goal for ourselves, is to create a brand where the tables turn, and where people from the Western countries come and want to buy this particular name rather than the other way around, which has been happening for the past few decades, right? And sure. I think that is our goal, and that is what will make us proud, right? And I think this is what we are looking. That is our ultimate goal, for sure.
On a perspective level, when brand would follow us, I think that would be the next battle. One is what we feel in terms of the perceived value. Like he said, like Ashutosh mentioned that, you know, looking up or maybe building an international brand is what we perceive, or maybe getting into every household kind of brand is what also we perceive, rather than putting into maybe a money or a other monetary value. Rather, why not get into each and every household? I think that should be a next big thing that we should try and build for ourselves.
Yeah.
Amen to that. And I'm sure you guys are definitely going to do that. Thank you so much for today's conversation. It was almost a lot of deja vu for me because for a lot of people who don't know, when I first started my entrepreneurship and I remember calling Ashutosh and I said, listen, I'm going to become an entrepreneur. He said, "Acha, chal bata kya karna hai?" And I was like, oh my God, if I ever become big or if I ever succeed in whatever I do, I think this is how I want to be, you know, for people around me. So thank you, Ashutosh, for that call one day. And, you know, it meant so much to me.
No, it is a pleasure. I think this is what we do, right? Me and Priyank as a team together also, we always come together, try to not only put money in startups, but actually back up these kind of entrepreneurs, these new age promoters, and give them the confidence that they need to, you know, make their businesses bigger, right? And that is what we want to do now. And I think that is also one of the additional part of our goals, to empower more and more entrepreneurs, right?
I am sure. I think you're already doing that. I know I can't say this on record, but I know you're already doing that. So more power to you guys. And thank you so much for giving me time together. I know it was very, very difficult for you to, like, you know, between so many things that you guys are doing. It really means a lot. And I'm sure a lot of people who will be listening to this will really, really learn from this conversation.
Sure. Thank you. Thank you for having us.
Thank you, Ashutosh. Thank you, Priyank. If you enjoyed this conversation, please make sure you hit the like button, comment what was your favorite part, and also subscribe to the channel. We have lots of fantastic people coming up. This podcast is available on your podcast app by the name Questions I Wanted to Ask. You can also follow me on social media for more updates, short format content. Links will be in the description.